For the Bible says, wherever two or three would gather, the Lord would be in the midst. And so, Lord, we pray for the service today and his people. And we thank you for being here with us today, Lord. We ask you now to remember each and every person that's been afflicted. Oh, God, heal their bodies, Lord.
Yes.
Lord, bring peace to them. And, Lord, bring joy back into their lives as we give you praise and glory. In Jesus' name, amen, amen, amen. I love the Lord. How about you? Well, mercy is fallen. Amen.
Mercy is fallen. Is fallen. Is fallen. Mercy.
Thank you.
Morning. Dan, 29th birthday. And I hear a rumor that, I don't know what day, but I hear a rumor that Ken Lyman's birthday is this month, too.
Aww.
Ken, if you're out there, happy birthday. Coming events, every day, Sunday, we have a Sunday school at 9:45, and our service starts at 11. Anybody that doesn't know that. And today, October 15th, we have a ladies' meeting following the morning service and a ladies' potluck. Stick around for that. The 18th, on Wednesday, we have Wednesday night service, 6:30 to 7:30. And don't forget, on the 5th of November, turn your clocks back an hour. We're going to do the fallback thing again. And November the 17th, we have a church Christmas decorating time with pizza, and it'll be at 6 p.m. if you want to come help decorate the church for Christmas. It's already coming up. Thanks. There's a bottom here says we have a Thanksgiving potluck November the 19th, and Thanksgiving menu will be on the table in there, so we'll get that out early if anybody wants to put anything out in the sanctuary. Sign up, bring a dish if you want. That's what I got.
Praise the Lord.
2 Corinthians 4:18 says, while we do not look at the things which are seen, but at the things which are not seen. For the things which are seen are temporary, but the things which are not seen are eternal. Mm-hmm. Praise the Lord.
Yeah. Amen.
Thank God.
Yeah.
We look up all the time, right?
Mm-hmm.
And if I had these stuff down here all the time looking at all this stuff, it'd be pretty depressing. But I mean, we can look at the things that are seen that we got that we enjoy. There's nothing wrong with that. All the nice shiny pickups and toys we got and all that. That's fine, but you can't take it with you.
No.
So we gotta look forward to something way better, right? Amen.
Amen.
All right. I'm gonna ask the ushers to come on up this time. Or you know you want to be an usher today? We have an offering.
I think I'll do.
Short staff. I was sick earlier this week a little bit. I got over it already about midweek. All right, let's pray. Father God, thank you so much for giving us another day to come to church today. And as we pass the plate around, Lord, I just ask that you bless every penny in it and every penny in that goes to increase your kingdom.
Yes.
And save souls.
So, I don't really need it today. I'm going to take it off and just use my regular voice, if that's okay. Well, thank you, brother. I got one too. I'm just too lazy to put it in. How many of us talk about this? I don't really need a microphone anyway. It helps when those low points. But I think I'm loud enough that everybody can hear me. What do you say? Amen.
Amen.
But before we go into the sermon today, let's go to prayer. And maybe you have a special need that you need the Lord. Just raise your hand up if you need a special need to be answered. You need God to answer your prayer. Raise your hand where I can see it. Amen. And let us do that, because if I start taking requests, it'd be quite a while before we could finish, but we're just going to pray for all of them in general. Amen. Raise your hands now. Father, you see all these hands going up, and they're all unspoken requests. All of them. But Father, you know the prayers. You know their hearts. You know what's on their minds, God, and on their heart, God. And so, Lord God, we come to you right now. We pray over all these needs and over all these afflictions. Over all this manner of things that's happening to each and every family in this church right now. We pray over them. We ask God to heal them. We ask God to answer their prayer requests. For the Bible says we're to make them known before God. And as we uplifted our hands with these unspoken requests, as we make them known to God, oh God, right now, with these people just whispered unto you, Lord, I pray for unspoken requests. I pray for our church. I pray for these church families that are sick and afflicted. I rebuke that spirit of flu. I rebuke that spirit of cold. And I rebuke that spirit that just hinders people with arthritis and all types of manner of things. And we're asking God to heal their bodies right now. Heal their bodies in Jesus' name. Heal them in Jesus' name, I pray. Lord, right now we confess this in the name of the Lord. Well, the Bible says if we'll pray in the name of Jesus that we can be made whole. And Father, I thank you for that. In Jesus' name, I pray for this sermon today, God. For this intended use of the Scriptures. Oh God, let my lips become your lips. Let my thoughts be your thoughts. Let my heart be your heart as I set forth towards you perpetually. That my eyes and my ears and my voice will become yours as I submitted to you, thy Holy Spirit. Oh God, have your way in my life and in the lives of all these others. Oh God, have your way in all of our lives, I pray, as we confess this to Jesus Christ, our Lord and Savior. Amen. He that have an ear, let him hear.
Yes.
She that have an ear, let them hear what the Spirit may reveal to them. In Jesus' name, amen. 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 I've been talking to you about Ichabod for the last couple of weeks, but I wanted to bring something else that's so important. And since this is Harvest Month, I want to talk to you about the harvest is truly plenteous. Amen. The harvest is truly plenteous. Amen. This is the Harvest Month. This is where all the harvest has been gathered in over the summer. And this is the time of celebration as we celebrate the goodness of God, as we, what, of all the fruit that was born and all the crops that were grown, amen, we want to give God glory and thanks for it. Can you say amen to that? Because there's going to be bread on our tables. Can you say amen to that? Amen. There's going to be grape juice in our refrigerator. Someone say amen or oh me. Amen. Someone asked me one time, said, do you drink wine? I said, yeah, it's called grape juice. Can you say amen? It's just non-fermented. What do you say about that? And it tastes really good. So have you ever had grape juice or with ice? Amen. Cubes of ice tastes really delicious. Amen. And I like that white cider. How many like white cider? And we're coming into Christmas time and Thanksgiving, so we'll be having some down on Wednesday nights. And also in our potlucks we'll be having them too. I'm getting ready for Thanksgiving holiday. How about you? Yes. Praise the Lord. Amen. And so we're going to have wonderful times coming up. God is truly going to be blessing us all. Amen. But I want to talk to you about the harvest is so plenteous. Amen. The harvest is truly white, the Bible says. In the old days, at the end of October, preparations were being made before the winter came to celebrate the collecting of the harvest. The Jews would thank Yahweh, Jehovah, the Lord God, for the harvest. Symbolically, Jesus referred to the harvest as truly white or ripe. In one scripture, he said it was overripe. He was says overripe. And so adjacent to his words, he wanted us to be aware of it. The harvest being what? Overripe, which means it needs to be what? It needs to be picked. It needs to be what? Processed. Or guess what's going to happen? It's going to rot on the vines. God doesn't want it to rot on the vines. He wants us to what? To pick it while it's fresh. Pick it while it's good. I don't know about you, but I love grapes. How many love those old California grapes? I used to live in California. And there's this huge grape field across the street. And I'd go over there. Sometimes after school, I'd walk across the street and pick a whole bunch of grapes and eat them. And while I was over there, the birds would attack me. How many remember those swallows? They'd just come down. They didn't like you messing around with their grapes, I guess. How was that? But they would actually have their young ones in the tree or in the grapevines. And that's why they were overprotected. But I used to remember going over there and picking those grapes and eating those grapes. They were just so delicious. Amen. And then I remember walking home from school, and I'd come across a watermelon field. How many remember the watermelon fields they grow in California? Be miles of them. I'm talking about miles and acres of them everywhere. And so I'd pick up a watermelon and put it on my shoulder and carry it all the way to the house where we'd have watermelon at night. And I didn't worry about seedless types because guess what? It was just normal. You spit the seeds out when you eat watermelon. How many know what I'm talking about? Today they got the seedless types, which I don't know about you. I don't know if I'm a fan of it or not, but I still enjoy the old-fashioned watermelon. How about you? Mom would put it in the fridge and we'd let it cool down and get really cold. And guess what? She'd slice big old pieces of watermelon. And we didn't take a fork or a knife and ate it. We just ate it like this. Yes. How do you remember that?
Oh, yeah.
We got it all over us. Mm-hmm. And then we'd get into, I know it's gross, but we get into spit seeding fights. I mean,
oh, yeah.
Low bastard. Mm-hmm. Gross. I know. We didn't have an Xbox in those days. So say Android games. We didn't have color TV. We had to watch TV on old black and white when that was big.
Yeah.
And most of the time you had to walk over there and pound on it to get it to work. How many remember those days?
Yeah.
It'd go off channel and you have to go there and go whack.
Yeah.
And all of a sudden it'd come back in. And just right out of a good scene of the TV, of the TV show, it'd go blitz out again. You have to jump up real quick and smack it. So I remember one time my dad had a stick where he was supposed to whack it out. You know what I'm talking about? Well, anyway, those are memorable times. And so we got back to the harvest. Then after the watermelons were being picked and all the grapes were being processed and harvested, and all of a sudden there'd be fields and fields of onions and fields of potatoes. But you know, the last thing they were able to harvest, believe it or not, was in the month of October and November, which was what? Oranges. How many remember that? There'd be fields and acres of oranges all over the place. I don't know about you, but you may not realize that the California grows almost all of America's food supply. I don't know if you realize that or not, but a lot of food is grown in California. And so it's important that we keep that food coming, what he said in Jesus' name. But that's not my story today. My story is to how truly ripe the harvest is. The harvest is ready to be gathered in, according to the scriptures. John's Gospel, chapter 4, verse 34, Jesus said unto them, my meat is to do the will of him that sent me, and to finish his work. John 4, verse 35, saying not, there are yet 4 months, and then cometh the harvest. Behold, I say to you, lift up your eyes and look on the fields. They are ripe and all ready to be harvested. God has sent a man. harvest is ready to be what? To bring forth its yield. The harvest is waiting for what? People that will become and do the will of God. I don't know about you, but we're all important when it comes to the Lord. We're all here for a reason, amen? You're not here just because of an accident. You're here purposely because God brought you here. And he wants you and I to become what? Harvesters in these last days. He wants us to go forth and bring forth the harvest and gather it in for him. Can you say amen? As we continue here, the harvest is truly plenteous. Matthew's Gospel 9 verse 37, this said he unto his disciples, the harvest truly is plenteous, but the laborers are few. When you look around, we have a lack of employment, not employment options or employment opportunities, but we have a lack of people to employ. Why? Because guess what? The harvest is plenteous, it's true, it's ready to be plucked, it's ready to be gathered in, but we're looking for more laborers. God is looking for more people to work his harvest in these last days. God is wanting to use you and me, amen, to reach out and touch others about Jesus Christ, to bring others before the great day of the Lord comes. I don't know about you, it's important that we do the Father's will. Can you say amen? We need to be about the Father's will. And this is what we're talking about today. Pray that the Lord will send what? Workers. Matthew 9 verse 38, he said, pray ye therefore to the Lord of the harvest that he will send forth laborers into the harvest. So what are workers and laborers? They are individuals who have a desire to follow Christ. These are who they are. They're people like you and me. Our desire is to follow Christ. Our desire is to be a laborer. Our desire for him is to love him and to be with him one day. I don't know about you, but we're all going to die one day. It's important that when we go, that we can take others with us. Can you say amen? Amen. You know and I know. There comes a day that time runs out. So it's important to be about the Father's business. It's important to be about his desire and do his will and do his bidding and do his desire as we look at it today. As we continue here, as believers, it's important that we follow Christ and his commandments. Why? Because these commandments direct our moral compass. They're the ones that gives us the ability to discern that which is good and that which is not good. You and I need the ability to discern what is good and not good. We need to know the commandments of our Lord. Can you say amen to that? We need to know God's desire. We need to know God's will. We need to be about the Father's business. Can you say amen? We need to be about his business today. This is God's will and desire that you and I be partakers in Christ as Christ is partakers in us. And it's so important that you and I begin to what? Reap what we sow. Amen. It's important that you and I reap it. A lot of times people take that negatively. But you can sow wonderful and good things. You can plant wonderful and good things in people's lives and in your own lives. You can plant a harvest that's worthy and will take note of that. And guess what? You can reap the benefits of that harvest. Why? Because you put your trust in God. Why? Because you were steadfast and unmovable. And guess what? You have succeeded doing God's will and desire. I don't know about you. But when the day comes, I want to be found faithful. How about you?
Amen.
If they want to write anything on my tombstone, is that I was faithful. Can you say amen?
Amen.
That's the thing they can write on there, that I was faithful to the end. And this is what I want to be found most importantly. Amen. Jesus said, follow me in Matthew's Gospel, chapter 4, verse 18. And Jesus, walking by the Sea of Galilee, saw two brethren, Simon called Peter and Andrew, his brother, casting the net into the sea, for they were fishers. Matthew 4:19, he said unto them, follow me, and I will make you fishers of men. Contrary to what they were doing. Importantly, at that very moment, they were fishing for fish. Kind of like the guys over there where I live. Every day they've been out there trying to catch the salmon. And one day, as me and Sister Pro was driving by, guess what? One of them pulled out one, probably about that big. It was a huge salmon. Pulled it out of the water. And then we stopped and asked him, how many did one guy? He said, I caught 4 so far. I says, well, great. Kind of like these guys. They were fishers. They wanted to fish the catch of the day. Why? Because they were fishermen. They lived off of it. Yes. This is how they supported their families. Jesus called them one day and said, guess what? Why don't you follow me and I'll make you fishers of men. They didn't know what in the world he was talking about. But they knew he was the master. They knew he was the Lord. They knew he was God's son. You know why? Because they saw and heard about his reputation. See, Jesus was already preaching the gospel 1 whole year before he ever met his disciples. A lot of people don't realize that. He already was engaged in his ministry 1 full year, and he built up a tremendous ministry. The multitudes were coming from everywhere to hear him. Finally, he went about and started gathering his disciples. And these are the first 2 he came across. He said, follow me, and I'll make you fishers of men. You know what they did? The Bible says they laid down their nets, sewed the boat, everything, and started following Jesus. Could you imagine Brother Peter going home talking to Sister Peter? So, well, I quit my job today, and I'm going to become evangelist like Jesus. Who? What'd you do? Don't you know we got bills to pay? A house payment? I could imagine everything going through the roof. But we're not for sure what happened. I kind of think she probably jumped in there with him and said, well, if you're going to do it, I'll go with you. Pack me and the kids up, we're going too. Amen. Who knows? But to give you an idea, they left everything to follow Jesus. Amen. As we continue here, not everyone will follow Christ. Matthew's Gospel, chapter 8, verse 18. Now when Jesus saw great multitudes about him, he gave a commandment to depart unto the other side. And a certain scribe came and said unto him, Master, I will follow you wherever you go. I'll follow you. Jesus said to him, you know, foxes have holes, birds of the air have nests, but the Son of Man hath not where to lay his head. He said, I don't know where I'm going to sleep tomorrow night. What did that man do? He pulled out. Quietly, he would not follow him. Another came to him and said, suffer, that I may go home and bury my family, my father. He said, follow me now. He said, let the dead bury the dead. That's a hard statement to make. That's a harsh one. How many understand what I'm saying? But you know what Jesus was telling him? He said, you've got to leave everything if you want to follow me. Well, I'll tell you what me and Sister Brooke did many times. I tell her, I said, well, we're moving to Idaho. What? We're going what? We're moving to Idaho. Are you sure? I said, yeah. Let's go. Pack up and go, man. Last time I told her, we're moving back to Oregon. What? Are you serious? She probably said that word too. Are you crazy? I can't blame her if she said it. I said, yeah, the Lord told me once to become pastor of this church. He said, I want you to leave it all. Give it away. Whatever you want to do with it. He said, I'll bless you when you get here. Boy, has he. Ever since I came to this church, God has just blessed me. Lately, he's been telling me, stay still. Don't go nowhere. That's what he's been telling me. He said, I want you to stay here. He said, you're in a good situation.
Yeah.
He said, I don't want you leaving. I want you to stay here. I said, you want me to go into pastor another church? He said, no, not right now. He said, you're where you need to be. Mm-hmm. I want you to know God's got plans here. God's got plans. He's wanting you and I to follow him. He's wanting you and I to become busy with him. He's wanting you and I to reap the harvest. He wants us to reap it. Why? Because it's overly ripe. If we don't reap this harvest, it's going to rot on the vine. We need to be about our Father's business. Not everyone will follow Christ. Not everyone. There was a young rich ruler came to him one time and said, Master, what must I do to inherit the kingdom of God? He said, you need to obey the commandments of Moses and follow the Ten Commandments. He said, I've done that from a youth. He said, well, thou lackest one thing. He said, sell everything you have and give it to the poor. For he said, in heaven you have great riches. And the Bible said he went away sorrowfully. He went away sorrowfully because he was very wealthy. And Jesus looked at him and said, it'd be easier for the camel to go through the eye of the needle than a rich man to enter into the kingdom of God. What would have happened if that man would have just gave up everything and started following Jesus? He probably would have been another apostle. Who knows what would have happened? How many other New Testament scriptures could have been added to the New Testament Bible? How many know? Who knows? Who knows what miracles he could have done? Who knows what he could have done in that name of Jesus? We'll never know. Brother Jeff, because he walked away from he had too much to give up in order to have Christ. This is how he felt. Jesus told him. He said, in heaven you got a mansion. In heaven you got wealth. You know that man's gone now. That man's dead. Can't you imagine when he died? He still faced the Lord. I don't know about you, but I'd rather be on the right side of God than on his wrong side of heaven.
Yeah.
I'd rather be on the right side of heaven than on the wrong side of hell. Someone say that earlier.
Amen.
I need to get a hat, put that on there. Amen. Amen. That'd make a good fundraiser, wouldn't it? Yeah, it would. That'd make a good fundraiser. You that are hat makers, there you go. Not everyone will follow Jesus. The question is, are we followers of Christ? Will we pick up the cross and follow him? To be a follower of Christ, we must be willing to pick up his cross and follow after him. Mark's Gospel, chapter 8, verse 34, and when he called the people unto him, with his disciples also, he said to them, whoever will come after me, let him deny himself and take up his cross and follow me. There are lots of runners at the beginning of the race, but only few cross the finish line. There's only few cross the finish line. Are you one of them finishers? Are you one of them finishers? There's a lot of people running the race. But there's not that many crosses. I've watched these marathons. I've watched the strongest ones cross the finish line. But I've watched all the others not make it at all. Carrying a cross is a life choice decision. Mark chapter 10, verse 21, did Jesus, beholding him, loved him, and said unto him, look, then thou lackest. Go thy way. Go thy way, sell whatever thou hast, and give it to the poor, and thou shalt have treasure in heaven. Come and take up the cross and follow me. Mark's gospel, I was mentioning this earlier to you, and he was sad at the saying, and went away grieved, for he had what great possessions. Jesus said in Matthew's gospel, or Luke's gospel, chapter 14, verse 27, whosoever doeth not bear his cross and come after me cannot be my disciple. You can't be his disciple unless you bear your cross. Unless you're willing to carry it. Are you willing to carry that cross for Jesus? Are you willing to gather his harvest? Are you willing to be his steward? Are you willing? This is what God's looking for. People that want to cross the finish line. If you start something, you need to finish it. Say amen or amen.
Amen.
You start something, amen, you got to finish it. Jesus said, what profit a man if he should build a tower and only halfway finishes it and runs out of money and can't complete it? He said, everybody be mocking him and laughing at him. He said, look at this going to waste. Kind of sounds like the world today. Look what they're building all over the place. And a lot of it's just going to waste. I can't figure that one out. So much good can be done. I've seen these jillionaires, I'll call them that. And I watch these, some of these YouTube videos where their mansions will go completely to nothing, run down, because they got so much money and so much wealth that it just, they don't care about taking care of it anymore. And I'm thinking, I says, wow, how they're going to be judged on judgment day. For remember, for much is given, much is going to be required. God expects you to take care of what he gives you. He gives you children, he wants you to take care of them. He gives you, whatever he gives you, he wants you to take care of them. God expects you to do your part. But I've seen these, like I said, some of these YouTube videos, mansions just deteriorating. Massive business complexes deteriorating. I saw a video in California. A city that was made something like 30, 40 years ago, 50 years ago. All the infrastructure, houses were built. Everything. And nobody living in them. What a waste. And I was thinking, I said, we live in such wasteful times. I don't know about you, but lately we've been eating our leftovers. How about you? Amen. Because every time you go in the grocery store, it's $100 just for a bag or two of groceries. We've been eating them green beans that are opened up from the last time around. We didn't eat them all. Or those pork and beans. Someone say amen or amen. Yeah. Or that leftover chicken. Mm-hmm. Hello. One day Pam was complaining about leftovers. I said, yeah, I know what some people, all they do is eat that leftover cereal in the box every week. That old leftover milk that's in the fridge. And she sat there just chopping down on the cereal. She looked at me like this. Yeah. I don't know why I want to eat leftovers for. I don't know about you, but leftovers are some of the best stuff you can. I mean, love leftover pizza, man.
Leftover
anything. Yeah, leftover spaghetti. Oh. How many love spaghetti and meatballs left over?
Yeah.
With brown beans, you pour the chili beans on top of the spaghetti. It just tastes so delicious. Anybody weird like me?
No. No.
No.
I would get the leftover. when I was growing up, in my big family of 10, there weren't no leftovers. I mean, once mom put it on the table, you got your part or you done without. That's the way it was. My wife asked me one day, she said, how can you eat so fast? I said, well, if you grew up with 10 others that are just like you, you'll learn to eat faster. Amen or oh me. I tell you what, we need to be about our Father's business. Can you say amen? There's a harvest there. It's really there. There's a beautiful harvest. It's just lacking the labors. It's lacking the manpower or the woman power. Amen? We need to be about God's business. Amen. Amen. As we continue, our witness for Christ is powerful. 1 Corinthians chapter 1, verse 18. For the preaching of the cross to them that perish is foolishness. But unto us which are saved is the power of God. At last did my Savior bleed, and did my Sovereign die. Would he devote that sacred head for sinners such as I? At the cross where I first saw the light, and the burden of my heart rolled away. It was there by faith I received my sight, and now I am happy all the day. Amen. At the cross is where it's happy. At the cross is where it happened. And the apostle said, for the preaching of the cross to them that perish is foolishness. But unto us who are saved is the power of God. I'm so glad that the cross changed me. I'm so glad that I kneeled before that Jesus feet. I'm so glad that I've been born again. I'm so glad to be part of this great work of God. Because it's at the cross, where I first saw the light, and the burden of my heart rolled away. It was there by faith I received my sight, and now I am happy all the day. It's at the cross where it all happened. That's where it all happened. That's where I found Jesus. That's where he restored me and changed me and made me whole again. I don't think there's any more. At the cross is where it all happened. Galatians 6, chapter 14. But God forbid that I should glory, save me only in the cross of our Lord Jesus Christ, by whom the world is crucified unto me, and I unto the world. The cross is where it all happened. It's so important that we carry the cross of our hope to reach out into a dark world full of unbelief. Truly the harvest is ripe. Pray to the Lord of the harvest that he may send forth but reapers to reap that.
Amen.
Reap the harvest. You've sown it. Don't you want to reap that which you sow? We always look at it as a negative way. That God is going to give us, that God's going to do vengeance for us. But that's not what it all means. It means that we have done a lot of good. Isn't it time that we reap all that good back? In the name of the Lord. Amen. Oh, I wish others could have heard it today. But you're the ones that heard it. The harvest is true plenteous. But the labors are few. You know, the Bible says also that we're not to be weary. We're not to become weary in doing well good. Or doing well good. Sometimes we've been doing this for so long that we can become weary in it. And that we're You're suffering because he suffered on the cross. Mm. You're suffering because you pulled and took that mantle of the Lord. You're suffering because he suffered. One day, truly, my friends, it's going to be worth it all. It's going to be worth it all. I promise you, one day it will be worth it all.
Yes.
It'll be worth all of it. Would you bow your head with me? Oh God, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Lord God, have your hand up on me and these. Lord God, walk with us and be with us. Lord God, I pray that we gather in your harvest. Lord God, help us to facilitate this harvest. Help us to reap it. Help us, Lord God. Send forth laborers. Send forth helpers, God. Give us helpers. You've given them to us, God. Now it's our turn to do our part. Oh God, lead us into people's lives that need our help. Help us, God. Guide us. Direct us, Lord, into all these lives that need our help and our attention. And that we become ministers of Christ. That we'll share the gospel of Jesus Christ to each and everybody here as we glorify the Lord and worship and praise Him. Oh God, touch our hearts. Touch our minds, God. Touch our minds and our hearts. God, that we'll be led by Thee and Thy Holy Spirit. Please, God, help us. Just ask the Lord to help you. Please, God, help us. Please, God, use me. Please, God, use these. Use us, Lord. Use us for Thy glory. Use us. Use us, O God. The harvest is truly plenteous, but the laborers are few. Help us, God. Help us. We praise you. We worship you in the name of Jesus. Maybe there's someone who says, Pastor, remember me in prayer. I've been really going through. Is there a person like that? I see these hands. Oh, raise your hands up where I can see them. Yes. Oh, God. Remember these people here that raised their hands. Help them, God. Help them get through this. Help them get through their struggles and their trials, oh God. Help them right now by the name of Jesus, I pray. In Jesus' name, I speak health into their lives. I speak healing into their bodies. I speak help and consolation to them, oh God. Console with them. Some of them are grieving and still been grieving. Some have been grieving for a long time. God help them as they overcome all these things, I pray. May the Lord be with you as He blesses you. Oh God, right now, for the rest of us, I pray, Lord, that you continue to build our faith. Continue to allow us to have mercy and grace towards others. Oh God, that will remember these that are going through issues in their life. And that will pray for them. And that will be not critical, but that will be loving and kind towards their needs. Oh God, let us be loving. Let us be helpful. Let us be courageous and kind. Oh God, let us have a sincerity about us that will reach out and touch others for Christ. Oh God, take us to our separate homes. Bring us back to the appointed time as we come to our next church service Wednesday night. Oh God, I pray for this congregation. Bless every one of them, God. Bless them. Bless them, Lord God. I pray in Jesus' name that you bless them. In Jesus' name I pray.